Hey, we have quite a panel tonight. In fact, if you were writing a headline, you could say we're going to hear from the three wise men, I think, tonight. No pressure on you speakers, all right? We're even going to see if they can follow a clock, because we're going to try to time them and hold them within time limits. We'll see if they're better than Congress is on those types of things. As you heard me say earlier, the House is going to split the farm bill between the nutrition and commodity titles. It's going to be interesting to see how that works. Probably going to do that, come up for a vote maybe on Thursday, perhaps. It's hard to have any confidence in this Congress because they haven't gotten much done. What they are good at is getting reelected. So we'll see if they can do something that helps them get reelected. Reminds me of the small town barber who wanted to do community service in his little town. So he decided that for a whole week, he would not charge anyone that came in for a haircut. And the first day, he opened his shop, and the first person in was the local florist. The florist sat down in the chair, got a haircut, went to pay, and the barber said, "I'm not taking your money, community service this week." The florist said, "Thank you very much." The next morning when the barber opened his shop, he found a box with a dozen roses on his doorstep with a thank you card from the florist. That day, the first customer in was the local cop. Local cop got a haircut, went to pay. The barber said, "Nope, community service, I won't take your money." Cop said, "Thank you very much." The next morning, when the barber came to open his shop, he found a box of a dozen donuts sitting by the door. That day, the first customer in was a local politician. Got his hair cut, went to pay. Barber said, "Nope, community service, won't take your money." The next morning, when the barber came to open his shop, there were a dozen other politicians there waiting for a free haircut. They are good at some things. Passing bills remains to be seen. I can remember many, many years ago doing my first interviews about precision farming. And at the time, I remember we were talking about, you know, maybe it's a good idea if we looked at a field, mapped it out, and could tell where some parts of a field need more fertilizer, some parts need less fertilizer. Why put the same amount on the whole field? And I thought, wow, why hadn't we thought of that before? That's pretty neat stuff. And then I started doing more interviews about precision agriculture, precision farming, and it all sounded pretty good, but it also sounded like something in the space age the Jetsons would do. It sounded so far out, I kept thinking, I wonder if any of this stuff will ever really happen. Well, it's happening, and it's happening quickly, and we're getting more and more precision agriculture to help you do your job even better. It is amazing how far we've come in a relatively short period of time, and it's amazing that we're just scratching the surface. When I said we have three wise men here, I'm not kidding. We have three individuals that represent companies that are at the leading edge of precision agriculture. I'm going to bring them to the stage. They're each going to have some opening comments, and then we're going to get into questions from you, the audience, about precision agriculture. You'll never get a better chance to talk with three more qualified people on this topic than we have here tonight. Let's again thank Wyffels for putting this program together that we have here this evening. This is kind of dangerous. They each have a microphone, so this could go long, but we can shut them off back there, right? If we need to, guys? Okay, all right. First, welcome to the stage, Mark Stelford, API and Data Management for John Deere Intelligent Solutions Group. Mark, come on up. Give him a big round of applause. You know what would be really scary if we're up here talking about precision technology and we can't get the microphones to work. So let's hope that this works, all right? Next, he and I were talking Cardinals. I forgot to ask, is this Cubs or Cardinals here? How many Cubs fans are here? Well, you're just gluttons for punishment, aren't you? I'm sorry. You folks need some good news, don't you? How many Cardinal fans are here? All right. Winners. That's what we've got. Winners there. All right. A Cardinal fan, John Raines, Vice President, Integrated Farm Systems for Monsanto. John, come on up. And also with us, Luke James, sales manager for SMS Software Products, AgLeader Technology. Give Luke a big round of applause. All right. This stage is carefully constructed, so if you go over your allotted time, it drops out underneath you. You fall into a big hole. You'll be in a deeper hole than the Cubs are in right now, and that's pretty deep, I can tell you that. Each speaker is going to have 5 minutes to introduce himself, tell a little bit about himself and his company, and some opening comments about where he sees us going, what's going on right now with precision agriculture. So let's go ahead and start right here. We'll start with Mark. Start us off. Mark, 5 minutes, please.
All right. Is this on? Looks like I'm good. Thanks for the opportunity to speak to everyone here tonight. As Mike mentioned in my job title, it includes this term API, which may be a little different for you, but I think that kind of speaks well to some of the things that are going on in precision agriculture. Basically, my job at John Deere, I work with the Ag Management Solutions Group, the folks that work on Green Star systems and the precision aspect of things. And I'm focused on more the data aspects of things. And specifically with these APIs are basically interfaces to allow this data to go into other business systems that you may want from your system to go into. So it's trying to facilitate that process and make it easier. So as part of this Green Star system or Ag Management Solutions, we've been talking in the marketplace a little bit about a vision that we have that we're working towards called John Deere FarmSight. Show of hands, who's heard of John Deere FarmSight? Okay? So we got some folks that are aware of it, but some folks that it's still news to you. So this was announced by the gentleman who heads up our marketing organization at AMS at the Commodity Classic a couple years ago. And it was really a bold move, I think, by the company. We don't talk about a strategy. We usually talk about things that we have that are available, that are new, that you could purchase. You could go down to a dealer and you could purchase. And this was the first time we felt it was so important to talk about this and raise awareness about where we're going that we had our marketing manager come down to Commodity Classic and make this announcement. So we're really driving towards taking things to the next level of increasing productivity of the machines, the uptime of the machines, the cost aspect of those, so you get a good value for the products that you're using in the field. And we're also very proud of our dealer channels, our dealer network. So we definitely see our dealers playing an important role in this process of making sure you can get the most out of your John Deere solution that you possibly can. So that's our goal in general for John Deere FarmSight, to keep to driving improvements, increases in productivity, machine uptime, the cost side of things, to manage that appropriately. All focused on trying to help realize that yield potential that's out there. So it's kind of a different way of looking at things for the company, but it's really helping us. Part of announcing a strategy is really helping to align the company itself, the folks within the company, to work towards that common vision. So looking forward to talking tonight some more about questions.
Great. Thank you. Now, you notice on the screen, he had 2 minutes left. This is not like Congress. You do not get to allot your time to the next speakers. That doesn't mean you get 7 minutes, John. We don't work it that way. You're on five-minute time, too. John Raines from Monsanto.
Well, you drive a hard bargain, Mike. Thank you. It's great to be here. As Mike said, my name is John Raines, and I lead an area for Monsanto called Integrated Farming Systems. I've been with the company for about 16 years. What I want to do tonight is I've got a few points that I thought would be thought-provoking to you. I want to start by telling you we focus, every day. Monsanto's core vision is around driving yield. We see ourselves as a yield company. Because we focus on genetics and improvement in genetics and improvement in biotech traits that reduce the risk or reduce the the potential for yield to be limited. Second thing I want to do is I want to talk to you a little bit about some of the things that are going on both at the farm as well as just in the world as it relates to technology advancement. So since we have arrived here, if we had gotten here this time yesterday, from this time yesterday to today, we've added about 250,000 people to the planet. In 2013, tablet sales, things like iPads, Androids, etc., combined with what was already in the house, How many households would have a smart system in their house today? On the farm, in the city, you name it. Over 60% of households have some type of smart computer system in them today. Over 60% of all corn planters have variable rate capability, seeding capability. Over 60% of all combines today that are harvesting here in the United States have yield monitors in them. Technology use on and off the farm is now the norm, not the exception. Since 2007, more than 300 million people have moved from rural China into the cities. It's expected that over the next 3 to 5 years, another 300 million will move from rural China into the city. Okay? That's more than the population of the United States. At the current pace of our birth rate of 250,000, I talked about a second ago, by the time we get to 2035, there'll be somewhere around 9 billion people on the planet. To supply these mouths, we need about another 1.75 bushels of corn over what we're built over another 0.75 bushels of corn what we're building today or making today. So we're going to go from a bushel to a bushel and three quarters. We need to go from one bushel of beans to two bushel of beans for every bushel of beans that's being produced in the world today. So the topic of precision agriculture specifically, if you think about precision ag, think about better utilization of what we have, our resources, and the ability to better utilize those resources and drive yield. Because at the end of the day, if we don't produce more with less, we're not going to get there. We don't have more land. We actually have less resources today, whether it be water or whether it be land, than we had yesterday, and that trend's going to continue. Nutrients are going to become tighter and tighter, both here in the United States and around the world. So as we stop and think about some of these, you know, key trends, one of the things that Monsanto has done is we have focused in this area for about the last 7 to 8 years on how do we produce more with less. In fact, we had a sustainable yield pledge that we came out with here back in 2007. Going back to 2000 and saying we want to double yields with a third less inputs for every unit of output that we produce on the farm, and we believe as a company we need to help support that activity. So as we think about integrated farming systems in the area that I lead, the first area is trying to take information that we have about our genetics and about biotechnology and get it to you on the farm in a form that you can use real time in the cab of the tractor. The first product out of integrated farming systems is going to be called field scripts. Field scripts basically is two things: a variable rate seeding prescription for a field and the best hybrid matched with that variable rate seeding prescription for that field. It'll be delivered wirelessly into the cab of the tractor. If it isn't simple, then you're not going to use it. And if it doesn't work, you're not going to use it. This past year, we had about 16,000 acres in research that delivered about 7.5 bushels of yield advantage in field scripts. Today, we've got about 160 farmers with a little over 50,000 acres of field scripts planted across Minnesota and the three I states. And we're looking forward to launching field scripts, the first seed prescription technology to go wirelessly into the cab of the tractor as we start in 2014. So that's what I'm here to talk to you about tonight, and I look forward to visiting with you. And by the way, thanks to the Wyffels crowd for inviting us here.
That was good, right down to 3 seconds. You ought to be in radio. That's good stuff right there. Next up, Luke James, AgLeader Technology. Luke?
Thanks, Mike. Like you said, my name's Luke James. I'm from AgLeader Technology. I actually grew up in West Central Illinois, so not too far from here, a little bit north of where Mike's from. Like you said, I work for AgLeader. We're a precision ag company based out of Ames, Iowa. We're a privately owned company. We've been around for 21 years. Our owner, Al Myers, was originally credited with developing the yield monitor. Actually, in 1986, he began working on the yield monitor in his basement. He started with a clean grain elevator off the side of a combine, a 5-gallon bucket, a scale, a stopwatch, and he would dump corn out the top. He would time it from the top to the bottom, dump it into the bucket, weigh it, and that's how he started the yield monitor formula. That was in 1986. In 1992, AgLeader started. We released the first on-the-go yield monitoring system, the YM2000. Since then, we've really integrated. We've developed into a full-product precision ag company. Like I said, all we sell is precision ag products. So we've been deep in the precision ag industry since it began. We've evolved from yield monitoring to variable rate equipment, like you talked about, with putting the right amount of fertilizer on the right areas of the field. Guidance equipment, we've evolved into planter, section control, population monitoring, advanced planter monitoring. And then kind of some of the newer technology we're talking about is active crop sensing technology. So like our optics crop sensors that actually measure what's happening in the field and then prescribe a recommendation based on what that plant needs or what it sees that that plant needs. Along with those hardware products, we've also been in desktop software, GIS software, for about 13 years. So in 2000, we came out with our SMS, a desktop software product, which is what you would use to read in precision ag data, like what we'll talk about a lot tonight, and then analyze that information and make a management decision based on it. And that's where I really see really the future of precision agriculture, even with our company moving into that data industry, because that's where the real opportunity is at. We are, like I said, we're a privately owned company. We're a very independent company, like a lot of you. We do have some OEM supplier relationships, but our primary sales are aftermarket sales. So we're in it to create products to bring value for you guys, for the farmers. And just like the yield monitor did in 1992, you know, we want to come up with those revolutionary products that are going to make a huge impact to your operation. Our owner, Al Myers, actually grew up in Illinois, believe it or not, even though probably 80% of the people that work for AgLeader are from Iowa State. He grew up from Illinois, went to the University of Illinois, and wanted to shape production agriculture in some way. So he emptied a savings account, started developing the yield monitor. You know, it's really taken off since then. But like I said, we value you guys. We want to supply you guys with the products that will enable you to gather the information, organize the information, and analyze that data to make a decision off of. So again, thanks for having me tonight. I look forward to the discussion.
Okay, this is how it's going to work now. I'm going to ask the first question to get the ball rolling. And they each have 3 minutes to answer the question. And while that's going on, I hope you've been thinking of questions that you want to ask. If you'll just raise your hand, I'll bring the microphone to you, and you can ask the question at whatever panelist you want to direct it to. So please just raise your hand, and we'll get a microphone to you. Let me start it off. Mark, we'll start with you. If you're looking ahead next 18, 24 months, what do you think will be the next biggest single advancement, achievement, breakthrough that we'll see in precision farming?
Yeah, I think it's actually here today. At least from a John Deere perspective, we're providing a lot of our equipment out of the factories with telematics on the machine. So the ability to wirelessly communicate from the machine back to you, to your dealer, to help improve the uptime and the productivity of that machine. Our product's called JD Link. Show of hands, how many folks have a machine that has JD Link on it today? So we've got just about all our machines coming out of the factories are having that right there on the machine, in base, ready to go. And we just see that continuing to grow. I think John mentioned a little bit of that on the seed delivery side, some of the things Monsanto's working on. So we see a lot of opportunities there for the customer to get even more out of those machines by being able to figure out what's going on with that machine remotely, to be able to, you know, reach out and touch that machine remotely, because a lot of you guys are out there, and gals, you're in pickup trucks, you're trying to manage from a pickup truck, not necessarily in the cab of the machine these days all the time.
John?
Yeah, thank you. I'll get this right before it's over with tonight. I think the convergence that I don't know if it's me or I'm talking right into it. So the convergence of seed technology, of equipment technology, and of computer technology, Mike, is what I think that we're seeing today, and we'll see a lot more advancement of over the coming decade to two decades. We're finding ourselves in a place today when 5 years ago, we knew a lot about seed, and we knew a lot about information through our breeding program, but we didn't have a means to get it to the field. Because if we give it to you on a thumb drive, and we give it to you after you've planted your crop, it doesn't do you any good. So the ability to take the type of equipment that the Deeres of the world are producing, being able to combine that with computer technology, so you've got excellent seeding and harvesting and even spraying technology out there today. Combine that with computer technology that allows wireless transmission of insight into the cab of the tractor or into the cab of the combine real time, but specifically into the cab of the tractor at the time of planting. And then the advancements of technology from a seed and germplasm and trait standpoint, and being able to adjust on the fly in the field, those three coming together should be able to deliver today 30 to 50 bushels of increased yield. The reason we don't have that 30 to 50 bushels today is because we don't have them all combined in the field today. That's the opportunity that exists.
Luke, better get your microphone back. There you go.
That one was actually just turned off on the bottom. No, I'm just kidding. Within the next 18 to 24 months, like both of these guys mentioned, I think you're going to see a lot of telematics. That goes with wireless information, wireless data transfer. Being able to set at your computer and look at and see where your machine's running out in the field, how productive that machine's running. In other countries, it's really essential that they know that those machines are running, period, and that the activity is being done. So telematics is going to be a big one. With wireless data transfer, machine synchronization, so sharing information from machine to machine. If you have two planters in the same field, you can essentially share that same coverage map back and forth. As well as just data management, getting the information from the machine back to the computer at home, being able to analyze that information, send a prescription back out to the field. I think you're just going to see wireless. Everything that lives in that wireless world, that cloud environment that we've all heard, everyone, I see a smartphone here, a smartphone there. You all have heard of the cloud, everything that lives in that environment. I just think there's extreme opportunity for transferring lots of information that way. And the second part of that, I touched on it earlier when I opened up, was the active crop sensing. I think we're just touching the tip of the iceberg with that technology. I think our owner, Al Myers, believes we're where we were with the yield monitoring in 1992 with this being able to actively scan what's happening in the field, use that information, either create a recommendation later or correct what's going on right now. Like with Optrix crop sensors, you can sense if that corn plant is deficient in nitrogen and it will prescribe more rate to feed that plant instantaneously. I think you're just going to see that technology explode moving forward.
All right, who has a question? Who wants to ask the first question? Raise your hand. Let's not be bashful. This is your big chance. Get to ask these guys a question about precision ag. Come on, don't be nervous. Who's got a question? We got one right over here. All right. This is a guy that's a politician. Earlier, remember I asked him who would have the bigger crop, Illinois or Iowa, and he said, would Illinois have the bigger crop? He said, could be. I think you ought to run for office with those kind of answers. Tell them who you are, where you're from, and go ahead and direct your question to whichever one.
Okay. Dennis Coffin down by Chatham, Illinois. And the question is to John Raines, is on these field scripts. Say you got, for example, you have maybe 3,000 acres of corn, and you got maybe 6 to 10 different numbers you're going to be planting, and you've got your planter loaded up, and you're over here on the west side, you get 2 inches of rain, and it's dry on the east side. Okay, do you have those 6 hybrids maybe set up for all different conditions so you don't have to clean the planter out, and maybe you got some experience from this spring, what farmers went through?
Dennis, that's a great question, and the answer in short is yes. So I also farm, and I planted a field scripts on my own farm this year and had some of those same challenges. What we'll do, let's take your 3,000 acres, however many fields you've got. Well, for the simple conversation, we're going to say you got 100 fields. So you got 100 fields at 30 acres. You're going to move from field to field. It rains on the west side like you just talked about, and you need to go east. If you've bought 10 fields of field scripts, We're going to load those wirelessly onto that iPad right out of the gate. You're going to have them all right there. If you're running two tractors and two planters, you're going to have them in both iPads and both tractors and planters. So that way you or the operator, if it's raining here and you can move over here, you're able to select the field, select the hybrid, and plant the prescription. Is that getting to your question?
Wait a minute. I know you're from Illinois, but you're not
that loud. So the planter's loaded with hybrid A or B.
Yeah. So you want to plant your early hybrids first because you want to take early harvest. So you're going to move that planter that was on the west side or two planters over to the east side.
Yes, sir.
Completely different soil type. Would you have a prescription? So you wouldn't have to empty the planter out for that field on the east side.
The answer is the prescription will be built specific to each field and specific to the hybrid. What we'll do is we'll give you, for field A, you'll have the opportunity to pick with your dealer three different hybrids as options for that field. You'll have the preferred, and then you'll have two other choices, hopefully. Every field will vary some, but I'm just giving you the rough estimate. You're going to have a hybrid for each of those prescriptions by field. I'm assuming that you'll have several fields that will fall into maturity, you know, in the early zone that you just talked about. There will probably be exceptions, I'm guessing there always is in farming, where you'll say, I'm in a place where this hybrid is not suited for where I want to go next. Based on what we saw this year on about 53,000 acres, I didn't get the first issue this time. Now, I'm not telling you it won't be, but what we're planning to do is load, if you've got 10 fields, they'll have 10 prescriptions in that iPad. It'll have multiple hybrid choices. They'll be matched up with the hybrids that you picked from the beginning of the year, and you'll have the opportunity in most cases to move field to field and pick a different, field that'll be matched to that hybrid.
You guys want to add anything? I know you're not, don't have field scripts, but the overall premise of what we're talking about?
I thought it was a great question because I think in general, one of the things that we see happen with leveraging these precision technologies when it comes to variable rate or documentation systems is that things tend to fall apart when you go to the field. You put a plan together and things, exceptions happen, right? And it's those things that I got everything ready to go. Now this gets switched out and I want to now execute this, or, and I got to document this. And so I find it, I hear that a lot from customers. And I know, I find it interesting that some of our dealers are actually hearing this as well, and they're coming up with programs to try to help producers make that process a little easier. So this is a pretty common issue, not just with the seeding prescriptions, just in general trying to leverage variable rate or documentation.
Okay. Luke?
Just what these guys communicated, as that wireless technology evolves, you're going to have the opportunity to send that information instantaneously back out to the field. So if you have the information, whether it's from a field script or if you've done your own research or worked with your own crop consultant, you have that data, you know, you have the opportunity to make that prescription change there. You know, as we know, we can't, as much as we want to, can't control Mother Nature.
Next question. Who's got a question? Raise your hand. Don't be bashful. Don't be shy. It's kind of like church, asking for an offering here, and everybody got quiet. Hands went in the pocket. Well, let me ask you this question. You just talked about data. You guys are, all your companies are collecting data. What about data ownership? What about use of that data? How does your company stand on that? Because I think there are probably some questions out there about that.
Sure. Well, for AgLeader, as far as data ownership, data management, our standpoint, like I said, we're a really independently owned company. We're a really independently run company. And that's how we believe a lot of our growers or our customers should be able to run, too, if they're using our equipment. So if you're using an AgLeader display, if we evolve into wireless data transfer and we have a storage solution, the data is yours. We're going to give you the opportunity. If you want to delete it, you delete it. We're not going to sell it. We're not going to share it with anyone else. We have no use for it internally. We're not going to sell seed. We're not going to sell fertilizer. We just sell precision ag products. As far as all your other agreements with all your other companies, I would just recommend you read the privacy statements. Know what agreement you're getting into before you share that information or give that information to someone else. Just do your homework.
John?
Yeah, the short is we feel like it's the farmer's data. So if the farmer is running a tractor and a planter, and that as planted data that's coming from the planter into the cab, or if they're running a sprayer on their farm, or if they're cutting the crop in the fall with their combine and that yield data, we believe that that data is the farmer's. As it relates to building prescriptions, and specifically on field scripts, we are going to ask if you want us to build a field script, there are going to be three things that we're going to need. We're going to need the AB lines or the borders of that field. We're going to need a current soil fertility test, and we're going to need yield history off of that field geospatially. Our commitment on that data that you share with us is we have a tremendous fiduciary responsibility. It's your data. As Luke just said, our philosophy, I think, would be very similar. Monsanto's philosophy is we can't share it with someone else. We can't sell you or try to solicit something to you off of that data. We can't give it to somebody else. We can't expose you. If you want to work with us on field scripts, we'll have a fiduciary responsibility that'll be clear in writing that it is your data, and we have a fiduciary responsibility to steward your data with the greatest of integrity.
At John Deere, I know we're very controlled on, we're very focused on being transparent and making sure that you're in control, you're in the driver's seat when it comes to the data that's coming off the machines. We do have an interest in building better products for you, better machines for you. So some of the things when you're having conversations with your dealer about JD Link, there is going to be some information there about what we're looking to do with that data if you agree to those terms. So please, you know, take a look at those, ask those questions. Our whole goal is to be transparent, to put you in control of that conversation. At the same time, I'd like to echo what Luke had said, that this goes beyond the three companies that are represented here. I think when we look at precision ag, leveraging documentation and variable rate, trying to get as much as you can out of this technology for your business, you need to, I challenge you to start thinking of all of your trusted advisors and all of the business partners that you're working with today. And are you, do you feel like you are leveraging all the data on your operation? I'm not saying the entire thing that you share with everyone, but is there, do you feel like there's opportunities to share select data with certain business partners that you can get more out of that relationship, more out of that insight to help your operation? And I think that's part of the challenge, like Luke mentioned, the cloud, and we're talking about telematics. It's really trying to put it into your situation. You're in the driver's seat. How do you want to leverage this data in your business with your all your trusted advisors, all your business partners? What are the arrangements that you have with each of those?
All right, we have a question back here.
I think, John, you mentioned the future could be 30 to 50 bushels an acre more. What kind of return on investment can growers expect right now from precision ag technology?
Well, I think that's a great question. It probably depends, on which area we're talking about within precision ag, but I'll poke specifically at field scripts because I think that may be your specific question. What we saw this past year in our research with field scripts was about a 7.5 bushel advantage over basically three different ways of, looking at seeding rates, looking at static rates, looking at normalized yield, basically taking geospatial yield out of a combine and using that to build prescriptions, and utilizing soil types to build prescriptions. The field scripts platform from Integrated Farming Systems basically looks at each field, and we look at a number of different factors, all the way from soil type to elevation to CEC to organic matter. That's why I talked earlier about the fertility test. Being able to, we have built a proprietary algorithm looking at our germplasm. We do over 50,000 trials every year with our germplasm. We've cross-referenced by relative maturity zone that germplasm, and we've done a tremendous amount of work, and the reason we started in Minnesota and the three I states is that's the bulk of where the corn is grown, and the bulk of where we've done our research over the last few years. We would anticipate that field scripts, when launched in 2014, will deliver somewhere in that 7 to 10 bushel yield advantage range About 70-plus percent of the time. This past year, we saw a 73% win rate. So take 10 fields. We won a little over 7 of those 10 fields with an average yield of about 7.6 bushels. Take that times $5 corn, you're talking about $35 to $40 of gross revenue. We are anticipating the product will be sold on a per-acre basis. It'll be sold separate from the bag of seed, so it's a full choice. If you are interested in trialing field scripts on a handful of fields, as the gentleman here in the front talked about, that's exactly what we want you to be able to do. We want you to be able to try it and see for yourself. And in fact, the see for yourself is one of the other things that we're building in these prescriptions is whatever your static or standard practice was. So if your standard practice in a field was 33,000, if this tent was a field, we'll build 33,000 in 4 or 5 places in that field, and then we'll have our prescription across the rest of the field to demonstrate the type of value that should be seen with field scripts. Okay.
Luke?
Thank you, sir. So your question was, what is the rate of return you can expect from utilizing precision ag technologies? That really depends on what technology you're using, but a few studies that I've read, that I've seen, Ohio State's done a study on sprayer section control, so outfitting your sprayer with boom sections. So as you go into an area where you've already sprayed, or an area, a waterway or somewhere where you don't want to spray, it turns those sections off, so you're reducing the amount of chemical you're using. You know, you're anywhere from 15 to 20 to even 30% savings, depending on the shape of your field. You know, some fields around here, or you get into northeastern, northwestern Iowa, where you get some pretty odd-shaped fields, you know, those savings are going to be even more because you've got more point rows there. As far as planter section control, you know, we're pretty fortunate that we're right next to Iowa State, so we can get quite a bit of research from those. We have a pretty close relationship with Matt Darr and a couple of the other professors there. But they did a study in 2011. They equipped a planter with a basically just with a GPS receiver and a display, and they just measured coverage the whole time while that grower was planting. I think he farmed around 2,000 acres. But what they saw was the amount of overlap, if you calculate that out into the seed savings that he would have saved on that operation, it was, I believe it was about $8.50 an acre from using row clutches on a planter. So it's pretty significant. You know, those savings are great because you can acquire them year after year after year, but they're static savings every year. I think the real opportunity for profitability growth in any farming operation is through data management. Even the smallest management change, let's say you're a grower around here and you grow 180 bushel corn, you make a management decision based on data that increases your yield 1%. So you're talking 1.8 bushel per acre. $5 corn, that's $9 an acre that you've just netted yourself that year. Off the smallest management change, if you make a change that, you know, increases your operation 5%, you're at $45 an acre. So you're talking pretty significant profitability just off of utilizing, looking at your information. And, you know, some of those management decisions are complex. Some of them are easier. You know, like you said, you've just got to surround yourself with your local trusted advisors, whether you need help answering questions from your agronomist, your seed salesman, your precision ag specialist. You know, don't be afraid to ask for help when you're looking through data. It's a beast. I mean, there's a lot of information there. It can be scary, but there's a ton of opportunity there too, a ton.
Mark?
Yeah, I would echo a lot of the comments here. I would say if you start with the basics with automated guidance or some sort of guidance technology, show of hands, how many people are using guidance in their operation? Okay, that's something, that's a foundational technology. If you have that, you've got a GPS receiver now on the machine. It allows you to do some other things. It's kind of a foundational piece. Like Luke mentioned with the row shutoffs or the swath control on sprayers. Again, show of hands, how many folks are using that on a planter or a sprayer today? So we're getting a lot of folks that are leveraging that. The one thing that we haven't talked about, though, and I know we're very focused on that at John Deere, is resale value. So when we talk about a cost of a machine, what is the resale value of that? And we're finding that having technology on that machine as part of that process of turning that machine in helps with the resale. And so I know a lot of dealers have talked to customers about that from a perspective of planters. So that's something that's starting to show up on the scene, that it's getting to be, I think John mentioned some of the penetration of some of these products, these technologies on machinery. It's starting to impact the resale of those machines.
Good.
I have one more question if I can ask. Obviously, there's a lot of uptake in this room of Precision Ag. Being global companies, what are you seeing from global competitors? So what are farmers in South America and Europe and Asia? Is this type of technology, is the uptake great in those areas? Or is, you know, who's leading the way right now, I guess?
I can start. That's a great question. We've recently opened an office up in the Netherlands to cover our European areas and South American areas. We opened an office, South African areas. We opened an office up in South America, and we're opening one up in Australia. You know, those markets, there's a ton of potential in all of those markets. If you start in Europe, they are heavily focused on government regulations, so they have to report everything that they do out in the field. They have to have that precision data to basically prove themselves for what they've done. They're really big on tram lines. They do a lot of management where they drive in the same area of the field to reduce compaction everywhere else. You know, their fields are a lot smaller than ours. They're pretty small when you get into a lot of those countries. You move into Eastern Europe and you're just seeing a new market kind of emerging. There's a lot more crops being grown there. There's a lot more corn being grown there. There's a lot of opportunity for precision ag. I'd say it's still relatively new in that area. You get into South America, some of the technology has been there for a while. They're doing a lot of the same things we are, only they farm, instead of a 180-acre field, they farm a 1,800-acre field or 5,000-acre field. So their areas are so much bigger, so their site-specific management maybe isn't quite like ours is. But, you know, they're moving that way. They obviously see the value in it. They've been doing a lot of that research themselves. It's they're very interesting markets. Then you get into markets like China, where we really haven't spent a lot of time in that market, to be honest with you, but, you know, they've got to feed their country as well, and, you know, that's a market that's going to be on the rise, too. It's a good question.
Yeah, great question. I try to add to the comments here, but I know it's been a couple years since I was doing some project in Argentina, but I was really impressed with how they were trying to leverage nitrogen in their corn production system. They were trying to get more out of the nitrogen than they were able to. You look at timing of the application as how do we get more out of it. When we go to Eastern Europe, we see some of the large farms in the Ukraine, they're struggling with this situation of, I cannot get as much fertilizer as I would like to have for my fields. I have to make a decision on which fields are going to get fertilizer and which ones aren't. And so that puts a producer in a very challenging position of decisions that they have to make. If we go into more Western Europe, we see a lot of, as Luke mentioned, a lot of pressure on the documentation, on the regulatory side. So there's a large drive to that, to do that. And we're seeing the need for these systems to talk to each other in Europe. We're seeing a lot of producers saying, this is not easy. These systems don't talk to each other. They need to talk to each other for me to do my job efficiently. So there's a huge effort coming out of that part of the world to try to address that we're trying to take advantage of and leverage for producers all over the globe.
John?
Yeah, I'll touch on two or three areas, hopefully not too repetitive here. If you look at North America and you think about seed technology, it's widely adopted both, you know, here in the U.S. and Canada, equipment-wise, both these gentlemen have talked about. It becomes a lot different when you go from geography to geography, whether you're talking about, you know, seed technology, you're talking about equipment technology. As you know, Monsanto also owns Precision Planting. And if you're in South America, specifically, you know, Brazil and Argentina, there's broad adoption of biotechnology today there. There's varying degrees of equipment technology. As it relates to things like yield monitors, it would be the Serratos would probably be the, you know, the greatest concentration. After you leave there, it gets a whole lot more limited. Pneumatic planters the same way. You know, you got pneumatic planters on the Serratos, you know, the northern part of Brazil. For the rest of the area, and specifically then going on to Argentina, it's much more mechanical and much more rudimentary. When you get into Europe, you get to both these gentlemen's point. Eastern Europe Western Europe is fairly advanced. Eastern Europe and Ukraine has got a lot of equipment technology. In many cases, though, you get a lot of variability on the ability to wirelessly communicate in the field in a lot of these geographies. When you get into South America, both Brazil and Argentina, 3G and 4G, very limited compared to what we have here, so you can't wirelessly talk to the field. In Europe, it depends on which country of the EU you're in. China and India, very limited depending upon where you're at in the countries. So it's much more fragmented would be the word I would use when you go around the world in total. When you put computer technology, equipment technology, and seed technology together, it's more fragmented than it is here in North America today.
Way over here, guys, over here in right field. Oh, here we go. Question coming out of right field here.
My question, I think, is primarily for John. When you talk about these productivity gains that you foresee with field scripts, do you see that productivity being equal among all the soil types in the field, or is there more advantage to be had in the poorer doing soils or the better performing soils?
Well, that's a great question, and I think time will tell the answer. Let me tell you what we've seen thus far. If you look in general, and I suspect I won't be far off in the room, maybe some of you will correct me, I'll tell you what we've seen in our research and what I've seen personally on my own farm, and that is that as a general rule of thumb, we're hesitant to seed at the highest potential that actually exists in the field because of fear of overseeding a bunch of areas that don't have as much opportunity or have issues in the field. And what we found is that we are missing the opportunity to push the populations in certain areas, i.e. you're at 33 or 34 here in the area, and we've got an opportunity to be at 36, 37 in a specific area of the field. But because of the fact that you don't want to be over 33 in another area of the field, it actually would be better off if we were at 31 in that simple example. What we saw on those two bookends is the highest producing areas of the field, being able to push the population, had about a 2-for-1 impact on yield increase versus the lower areas. So in other words, if I take the lowest producing area of the field and if I seed right, what I'm doing there is I'm limiting my risk. I'm actually seeding the right amount, and hopefully over time we're adding what my colleagues here have shared. You know, it's a much more holistic view, whether it relates to the way you're fertilizing those areas of the field or the way you're managing them if you have irrigation. And the same way on the upper end, you're not leaving money in the field by not pushing the envelope as much as absolutely possible. Is that getting to your question? I've still got time here. I just want to see if I'm hitting on it.
Got it? You good? Okay. Another question? Anybody else over here? Next question from the audience. Okay, I'll ask one. Guidance systems. Mark, you brought this up. Where are we going with guidance systems? I mean, what's the potential out there? Are we really going to get to a point where you go out, push the buttons, program the equipment, and let it go? Is that too far out there, or where are we headed with it?
Good question. It's hard to tell where we are headed for with that. I would say we spend a lot of time at John Deere, and I know other equipment manufacturers, thinking about safety. And that obviously pops up right away when you start talking about a fully automated machine out there. We are seeing some exciting things, though, that we can leverage. And so today we have a product called Machine Sync. I don't know if you've heard of this product or not, but as you've seen your combine, the head on the combine's probably gotten bigger and bigger over time. The grain cart that's coming up against you is probably getting bigger and bigger, so it's getting to be a more difficult dance between that head and the cart. So in that case, we see an example where the combine operator can take over control of the tractor and position that grain cart where they want it to evenly fill that cart and not damage, run the risk of damaging those two machines colliding. So that's kind of moving in your direction, Mike. It's one real tangible example that's out there. I know we've seen some things of fully automated prototype activities, but in those cases, safety always pops up right away.
Go ahead, Luke.
No problem. I think the technology is already there, and I think it's been there for a while, but like Mark said, it's a matter of safety, liability. You know, some of our friends right down the street here at Kinsey, they've already done this. If you get on YouTube and you look at the autonomous grain cart, you know, there's a video of it chasing down a combine, receiving grain, and then coming back, back to the semi to unload it. And I was talking to one of my friends there, and while they were testing it, he actually said that there was a gentleman that was jogging down the road, and he saw a grain cart and a tractor and nobody in it. And he stopped and he got out his phone and he called 911. He's like, there's a tractor on the loose out in the middle of the field. So the whole public awareness part of it, I just think there's a lot of education that's going to have to go into that, the safety, the liability. But like I said, the technology is already there. I think more recently you'll see machine synchronization. I think that technology is, you know, at the forefront, and it's almost there. And I think there's going to be a lot of efficiencies and different items like that can be built in, and we can kind of build off of those blocks.
Let me ask you this, and I want to compliment the three of you for being here and appearing on a program like this. We all understand competition. Each of your companies in business, but to achieve the goals, John, that you were talking about, it would seem we're going to have a certain amount of cooperation between companies. This all has to be integrated to work at peak efficiency, I would think. How do you see that playing out? I know you can't always speak entirely for your companies, but do you see a cooperative effort in precision agriculture to help producers maximize their production potential? John, I'll start with you.
I think, Mike, the short answer is yes, and I'll give you two reasons why. One is, one of the things that we've learned tremendous information about over the last 7 or 8 years is you can have great knowledge about how best to plant a particular hybrid in this field. But if you don't, and if you want to, let's say you want to do that on a variable rate seeding prescription across the field, if that planter won't plant within 500 seeds per acre, and if I want to go and our management zones are built on 30 feet squares, and if that planter won't change from seeding rate A of 33,000 to 38,000 in 5 linear feet a row, if you are moving at 5 miles an hour, by the time you get 20 feet across that zone, it's not going to do you any good. You're going to leave bushels in the field. So I believe the convergence of equipment technology and computer technology, because you've got to have wireless connectivity. If you can't, while you're running that planter, if you can't see information on the cab screen that tells you you need to stop and you need to make an adjustment either to the pressure, up or down pressure, if you can't figure out or see that you've got a singulation problem, all of those types of pieces of information are yield. They're yield, it's a lost opportunity cost. And so that combined with seed technology and the knowledge or the insight of how best to plant that seed and care for that seed across the field throughout the season, those three are where that 30 to 50 bushels under today's regime stands. And I can tell you through our own research, working with partners like John Deere, we have been able to see exactly what I'm talking about right now. I could take you to fields where we harvested last year, and when you combine these technologies and you take this type of information, you put this kind of precision to it, there's a tremendous amount of yield. And I'm going to combine that with, which means that there's a tremendous amount of risk that's being reduced out of that field, because most of the fields here in Iowa, I'm going to guess you're spending anywhere from low side of $300 to high side of $500 per acre, not including the land cost or the rent. So it's we're talking about big money and big opportunity, and I think that we've got to put all of them together if we really want to capitalize. So I do think we have to have really good partnerships across the industry.
Mark?
Yeah, I would. Speak to another effort that our three companies are doing in addition to other companies in the industry, where we're part of an Ag Gateway organization. And so that's an organization that has a lot of the players in the industry sitting around the table talking about how to make it easier for data exchange In the case where you want data exchange to happen, like we talked about earlier, how do we make that process easier? And so it takes a while to get those details worked out and then for us to implement them, but it is encouraging to see that we are having active conversations about that, and we're working towards that. The other thing I had mentioned to a question earlier was a lot of requests from growers in Western Europe about things in the field aren't talking to each other, and we got to make that process better. And so there's an effort that kind of ties in that gateway effort that's focused on that specific piece as well. So a lot of activity, a lot of folks in the industry recognize the need because you've been telling us that you need this to be easier.
Yeah, you know, I'll just reiterate what these guys mentioned. You've got to have that flexibility to be able to share your information, your data with all your partners that you're working with that can help you make decisions off your data. Us being an aftermarket company, a lot of our products that we sell can be outfitted and installed on different types of machinery. Our desktop software that we sell, our SMS software, it has the ability to read from all the precision ag display formats on the market. So we realize that each of your operations probably has a different piece of equipment on it, maybe a different display. You need to be able to take all of that data, all that information, because that information is extremely valuable. Combine it together, be able to layer that information, and like I said, work with your trusted advisors, work with your trusted partnerships, and make decisions based on that data. And the ability to share it with them, and the ability to read in all those different formats. I think that's a must have today.
Okay, we have a question over here.
So I've heard you guys talk about data ownership and the cloud and all the data that's out there. My question is, somebody who, I watch markets on a day-to-day as a grain merchandiser, and every USDA report, I'm sitting on the edge of my seat with all this data floating around in the cloud. How can we better utilize that data, whether it be transferring it to a USDA department, which I'm not saying that's a good idea, but is there any way that we can better equip our reporting systems to allow information that we trade upon to be accurately represented what we're actually doing in the field?
I could start on that one if you want.
He wants USDA to get their heads out of their clouds.
Yeah, that's the first farmer I've ever heard say that.
The cloud sounds better than what else I think we could have said, but I think a lot of people probably wonder, how does USDA come up with these numbers? And if you've got all this technology, right, why can't we better use it and get more accurate reporting out of USDA? Is that right?
Yeah, and they're already using a lot of that for crop insurance reporting today. RMA has made it clear that you can use precision ag data for reporting your acreage information. And if you've reported your acreage information, you can use it for your production reporting as well. So that's already being implemented now. There's still some, we'll call them gray areas in there. You still have to calibrate per the manufacturer specification. The calibration is a whole other thing where if your data is not properly calibrated, especially grain harvest information, it's not going to be accurate. So you've got to be really careful for what you're reporting or what you're using to report that you've gone through per the manufacturer specifications and you've calibrated that monitor to be accurate in those different environments. For our monitors, we calibrate with 5 loads. We use a non-linear calibration curve. So we're calibrating for the low yielding areas in the field, and we're calibrating for the high yielding areas in the field. So once you've calibrated it that way, then you've basically trained the monitor to be accurate across the entire field. You can calibrate your monitor with one size load, with one load, and you can be accurate. You can be within 3% over your whole operation, but you may be dead on your high yielding, and you may be 10, 15% off on your low yielding. Maybe you have less low yielding than high yielding, but you can have that variance in there. So again, you've just got to be careful what information you're using. You want to make sure that it's accurate. But to answer your question, yeah, they're already starting to use some of it. I don't know about some of the the production side of it going into production, but as far as final production, acreage dates, yeah, they're using that data now.
Yeah, I would echo what Luke was saying there, but maybe give a little different twist on that. If with the crop insurance effort, for example, was excited to see organizations like the National Corn Growers having an interest in trying to leverage the technology to help them help their members submit those that information for crop insurance purposes. But I think fundamentally it comes down to the reason I think of that example, it's because it's something that the growers saw value in doing and they wanted to do it. And so you had to work through some of these details like Luke's talked about to make sure you do it right, because that's important. But at the end of the day, I think you're going to see more and more of that as we go forward, is you're going to have, and it may not even be ideas that you've thought of, you may be approached by folks with ideas, hey, if you would let me do this or that, you know, there could be some value there for you as for participating. And so I think that's an aspect you're going to have to start thinking more and more about, is how do you weigh those opportunities for your own operation, and does it make sense for you to participate or not, and what does it take for you to participate? So I think we're going to see more of that going forward.
Maybe a little bit different twist on it, but one of the things that we spend a lot of time on right now in my group is how do we anticipate the pitch? So what we do with most of this data today, no offense to anybody in the room, by the way, Monsanto is guilty as charged, we look at the data after the fact. So we take all that information that you get off that machine, or we take information we have off soil types and fertility, et cetera, and we analyze what happened yesterday, and then we think about, okay, how can we take that and how can we get better as we think about tomorrow? I believe that there's a huge opportunity. I'm talking about billions of dollars of opportunity to analyze what could be a better way, in other words, an insightful way to manage things. Let me give you a simple example. We had one of the wettest years this spring we've had in how many years? No telling. Some of the gentlemen I was sitting with tonight says worst one he'd ever seen in 43 years. But we've got a group, just a real simple factoid. We got a group called the NOAA, National Oceanic Atmospheric Association, okay? Well, there's a lot of people that are taking NOAA's information and looking at years just like this year and analyzing temperature and humidity and rainfall, et cetera. And what if we were able to say, well, instead of wondering whether or not you ought to be planting corn on June the 20th and foregoing the planting dates, and I'm not talking about just this area, but just in general in my simple example. And what if I could say that, hey, over the course of every year that this has happened over the last 100 years, over the last century, I can tell you that every time it's happened, when you plant past this date, here's how many yield, here's how many bushels it cost you. Here's what kind of disease typically is going to occur. 80% of the time, you're going to have disease X, okay? What if real time, when that machine's running through the field, you're able to actually stop and say, hey, I've got a singulation problem, and I know that ultimately, or I've got a down pressure problem, and I know that if I don't ultimately have all my corn come up within 12 hours of each other, for every hour that it takes for 5 or 10% of that crop to come up at a different rate, let's say it comes up over 3 days versus in 12 hours, I could be leaving 8 or 10 bushels in the field. An 160-acre field. If I knew that right now, real time, I could make that adjustment. I believe that the opportunity that exists in front of us is to utilize information more like the hockey analogy, skate to where the puck's going, not where it's been. And I think the opportunity that we have as an industry is to collaborate across the companies and to be able to look at information real time and be able to give you much more insightful information, either through here's something that's likely to happen based on what we've seen in the past, so take that information, do it differently as you go forward, or stop right then and be able to make a course correction and be able to help you real time, be able to either increase yield or reduce risk as a result of it.
Time for one more question. Does anybody have a question? Right up here. Okay.
This is a field script specific question. The rollout in 14 of field scripts is just DeKalb. What about the other companies, associated companies? Will that be in 14 also, or ever, or what's the plan there?
Great question. So just because I was having a little bit of trouble hearing. So field scripts this year was only in the DeKalb brand, and it was in four states, the three I states in Minnesota. We will launch field scripts in 2014. Only in the DeKalb brand. The only reason for that is because it's where we had the most amount of data on our germplasm pool. We are actively working with the Wyffels team and our partners. We would anticipate very quickly behind 2014. I don't know if it'll be 2015 or if it'll be 2016, but somewhere in that time frame, we would anticipate that the Wyffels brand and other brands would be in a position to be able to offer field scripts. And then the other piece is being able to expand it across broader geographies than just those four states that we talked about. Okay, thanks.
Okay, we'll wrap things up with some closing comments from our panelists. Mark?
Well, thanks again for the opportunity to visit with you here this evening. I hope you've got a better perspective, some more insights on what we're trying to do here at John Deere to help you leverage this technology, this precision technology that we have available today, as well as just to reiterate again some of the things that we see as the opportunity for what can be enabled with telematics. And so we've made a huge commitment with our JD Link product to put that into base on most all of our machine models coming out of the factories. Really hope that you work with your local dealer to leverage that technology as much as you can in your business. We'd look for you to leverage that even more going forward. And lastly, be looking for more things about John Deere Farm Site. So again, it's kind of unique for us to be able to talk about a strategy in the marketplace. It's pretty unusual for John Deere, but that's how much we're putting behind that, working to align all of our factories, all of our organization behind that to help improve the productivity that you're getting out of your machines, the uptime, the cost perspective we talked about, resale value, for example, and really help you realize as much as you can about the yield potential that you have in those fields that you're managing. So thanks again for the opportunity.
Great. Yeah, I'll just leave you with a very quick suggestion, and that is that there is a lot of opportunity between computer technology, equipment technology, and seed technology. If you're not today utilizing some of the technology of these equipment companies, I believe you need to start trying it, and the reason why is because it'll be essential to running prescriptions, whether it's seeding prescriptions, whether it's fungicide prescriptions, etc. It'll be essential. If you're not utilizing computer technology today, real-time information shared between you and your employees, between you and companies that you work with, will be essential, and the same goes for seed technologies. So that's one of my suggestions based on just the learning that I've had over the last few years working in this area globally for Monsanto. Second thing I want to do is I want to thank you for your business. I know many of you in here are our customers. We're grateful for the business that you do with us, and we appreciate the opportunity to work with you. We hope we have the opportunity to earn your business in the future. And then lastly, I just want to thank the Wyffels team. They're great partners of ours. We really appreciate the partnership, and we think that they're a great company to do business with. Thanks for having us here tonight.
Thanks again, everybody, for your time. I want to thank the Wyffels team as well. It's great that they put on these types of events where you as farmers can come out, you can learn about the newest cutting-edge technologies, whether that's in seed, fertilizer, or precision ag. You can visit with us. You can set in on their sessions tomorrow. I mean, it's just a real learning opportunity. I would encourage all of you to continue down that learning path. With precision ag, that's what we focused on tonight, and there's a lot of aspects to it. It's a big field. There's data management. We talked about guidance. We talked about wireless telematics. We used a lot of terms, but there's a lot of opportunity there, like we talked about as well. And I would encourage you, if you're not already, use precision technology, whether it's AgLeader or John Deere or whatever brand it is, use precision technology, gather that information, and then, like we mentioned, work with your trusted advisors. Be involved in the process. Be a part of that discussion, too. There's a lot of things that happen in that field that may have happened this year, last year, 5 years, 10 years ago, that's not recorded in precision data that you as the grower are going to have the information for what's happening in that field. So be involved in the process. Work with those advisors. Just get hands-on in it. Thanks.
Well, I told you at the outset we had a great panel. I mean, you can go back home and say you heard from Mark, Luke, and John. If we'd have had Matthew here, we'd have had it covered, wouldn't we? I mean, you talk about three wise men. We've got them right here.